Hi, good afternoon. You know, it's always exciting to be in Jaipur. The last time I was in Jaipur, I was tracking this gang of wildlife traffickers who had smuggled a baby elephant into Jaipur and they were planning to send it to Nepal. So I had spent 4 days the last time when I was in Jaipur, and 4 days I had four different identities, but this time I'm here for the talk. So my journey started as a wildlife conservationist 5 years ago when I joined a conservation organization called Wildlife SOS. Over the years, I have developed specialization in the fields of understanding and studying human-wildlife interaction, developing innovative conflict mitigation solutions, and also a lot of wildlife crime control. I've done a range of projects involving rescue of snakes, lots of snakes, monkeys, leopards, sloth bear, elephant, crocodiles, and arresting people who were trying to smuggle wildlife and making money out of it. Today I'm going to talk about three very special stories during my 5-year journey as a conservationist, and these three stories are perhaps the most challenging wildlife rescue operations that I have done. The first operation, it takes us to the state of Maharashtra. First of all, I would like to tell you a little bit about the elephants of India. Elephant is the national heritage animal of India. It has provided protection under a law called Wildlife Protection Act, 1972. And it's supposed to be left in the wild, but people are actually poaching the elephants from the wild. They are keeping them in captivity. They're using them for performances on the streets, making money out of it. They're using them for tourism. They are using them for performances in the circuses. All of this is illegal as per the Wildlife Protection Act of India, but it is happening. As we speak right now, we are looking at over 3,000 elephants in captivity in India. Gajraj was one of those elephants. Gajraj means king of elephants. So a little bit about the history of Gajraj. The elephant is very old. In a place called Aundh in the state of Maharashtra, about 8 hours away from Pune city, so the elephant was a temple elephant, had been a temple elephant for several decades. And we were informed that the elephant needs urgent medical attention. So we sent a team to the location to inspect what is happening to the elephant. Upon inspection, we came to realize that the elephant has partial blindness. The foot sole, the foot are all deteriorated, and it is likely that if we don't give a proper treatment to the elephant, it is likely to go lame. So we just had to rescue the elephant and take it to our elephant sanctuary in Mathura, and we started off the operation to rescue Gajraj. While we were getting ready, you know, the team and everyone, we were getting ready to rescue the elephant, our team arrived from Mathura to Pune and setting up the entire paperwork, and we were planning to just leave for this place called Aundh, but this is what was happening in Aundh. There were processions. Few people who were misinformed, they were trying to give it a religious color. You know, they were trying to say that you cannot take the elephant away from here, and they were trying to create chaos. And because of that, we had to postpone the operation for 24 hours. I had to go to Satara, and from Satara, I had to go to Aundh, dressed like a villager. It was an undercover operation to understand what is actually happening on the ground. When I reached the location, I realized that the elephant has been locked in a compound and there is no access at all. And then we contacted the police and enforcement agencies. And then we figured that if we bring the ambulance all the way into this place, they won't let us go out. And the police, irrespective of how big the force is, it is likely that there will be trouble and the elephant will be put in danger. So the idea was to take the elephant early in the morning. So the same evening, I leave from Aundh back to Pune city, where my team is waiting for the further instructions. Midnight, I reach Pune city. There's no time to rest. At 1 in the morning from Pune city, we leave back for Aundh, because we were thinking that early in the morning, 4 or 5 in the morning, we will go and rescue the elephant. The plan was to bring the elephant out of Aundh and load it in this ambulance. This is India's first elephant ambulance. And so we were setting up the entire place just to load the elephant, but situation was still like this in Aundh. Despite of the assurances from the representatives of the community, people were still trying to provoke the entire mob. So when we again connected with the authorities, they said that they just want to say goodbye to the elephant, accompany to the elephant all the way to the loading site. They reached the loading site. I am standing on the top of the ambulance, just coordinating the entire rescue operation, and I just noticed that a stone just flew past my face. And before that, I was actually thinking people were, you know, in local languages, people were saying goodbyes to the elephant, but then I realized that they were actually abusing us. So the plan was that we have to now control the situation and not react, because if we react, people get provoked and it can lead to a lot of issues. There were so many challenges in loading the elephant because people will keep yelling from behind, a few antisocial elements. They will keep trying to not let us load the elephant. After hours of struggle, we finally decided that we have to change the loading location, take the ambulance to a forest land, and technically if anyone enters a forest land, that is trespassing. So we took the elephant to the forest land, that is Gajraj being moved to the forest land, and that is where the loading happened. Now here we see a different truck. We realized that the elephant had been so stressed after so many efforts of trying to load it onto the ambulance that it was not getting on the elephant ambulance. And we wanted to get out of there as soon as possible. So we got this open body truck to load it, took the elephant to Satara, and that is where the exchange happened. And finally, we were on the way to Mathura, escorted by police department people and forest department officials. Now, this is interesting. When we do these journeys, these can be 2 or 3 day journey, and we stop only when the elephant needs some rest or needs to be fed. And we always try to interact with people we, you know, come across when we are doing these operations. For example, in this case, just a guy who is selling watermelons, but even that guy has to be informed about conservation. And we try to, you know, do these kind of educational awareness programs while we are on the way. Just to keep the elephant cool, because it was during the summertime when the rescue operation was taken off. The night before we were about to reach the elephant sanctuary in Mathura, the vehicle broke down and we were all very tired at that time. But this is just to give you an overview of the situations that we come across when a rescue operation is going on. Now, we cannot afford to lose even a single minute because there's an elephant which needs urgent medical attention. So somehow, since we carry all the backups over the years, we have realized with the experience the kind of situations which can develop. So it did not take us too much time to fix the ambulance and the vehicle. And finally, Gajraj arrives at the Elephant Conservation Care Center in Mathura. The first thing that the elephant did was enter into the pool. The elephant is in the pool, and all of us, after days of no sleep, no rest, finally got some rest. The second story was a very tough one. This one takes us to Nepal. So in India, until about 2008, 2009, there was a practice which had been prevalent for about 400 years since the Mughal era. That was the practice of dancing bear. The bears were being pushed from the wild, used for performances on the streets. The practice ended in India around 2008, 2009, but it was still going on in Nepal. Two sloth bears were pushed out of a forest in India, smuggled into Nepal, but confiscated by authorities in Nepal. They were kept at a facility in Nepal. One bear died. The second bear was critical. That is when we came to know about the situation and we had to set up an urgent repatriation operation, bringing the bear back to India, taking it to a specialized center for necessary treatment. So the plan was that I'll go there first, do all the liaison work, get the paperwork in place, meet all the officials out there. We have to get the paperwork done from both the sides, India side, Nepal side. We have a lot of custom regulations that need to be followed. We don't really have regulations specific to wild animals, so everything goes through the customs. And we have to go through several ministry approvals to get this thing done. In this case, we even had to get the Indian High Commission in Nepal to intervene. And a cabinet approval was passed in Nepal by the Nepal government to return the bear back to India. Now, this is a very critical situation when the second photo, the round table photo, several things are happening. We are about to get the final permits to take the bear to India. At the same time, I'm getting an alert on my phone, a weather alert, that severe, very severe rainfall is expected around the border of Nepal and India. Now it's a very tricky situation because the plan was we rest the night and the next morning we have to leave for India. But now, if the weather forecast is saying that in 12 hours you expect very heavy rain, we cannot take the bear back to India because the route is very rough and tricky. So we had to prepone the plan to get back to India. And the third thing was, the third story which I'm going to tell you about, that notification came to me when I was sitting there about the third operation that has to be carried out. And so finally it was decided that I have to get back to Delhi and not accompany the team by route to Agra. So the team, they left for India, and I left for Delhi for the next operation. This is the team getting ready to load Rangila Bear onto the ambulance, which was brought all the way from Agra into Nepal in Kathmandu. And we had done all the veterinary checks before the bear has to be loaded onto the ambulance. That is Rangila Bear being loaded onto the cage for transportation into the ambulance. That's the animal ambulance in Kathmandu. Now this is Rangila Bear at the Agra Bear Rescue Facility. But before that, a very intense situation built up. I reached Delhi that night, around midnight, and I realized that because of the weather conditions getting bad, the network coverage for the team which was on the road had disappeared, and we had no idea where exactly is the team. So we were just waiting. And then I came to know that I have to leave for Bangalore. The same night, I leave from Kathmandu, I reach Delhi. From Delhi, now I have to reach Bangalore the same night. And I'm just waiting for the team to send me some update to get, you know, in the network coverage. But finally, at 3 in the morning, I finally get a message from the team leader that we have entered into India. And finally, we could relax that now that we are back into the home country, the bear will be safe. And we were escorted by Forest Department officials from the border all the way to the bear facility. The third operation, which I mentioned, was STARS, Indian Star Tortoise. We have Indian Star Tortoise in several parts of India. Not a very comprehensive study done on this particular species, but there is a huge problem building up for this species. You can see some statistics on the screen. Indian Star Tortoises are being poached at a massive scale, and they are being smuggled into Southeast Asian countries because they are the most popular wildlife when it comes to international pet trade. And they are being used as, they are being consumed as a food delicacies as well. This was a particular case where the Indian Star Tortoise, about over 50 of them, were smuggled out of India but confiscated by authorities in Singapore. Now, Singapore law is very strict about these things. Since Indian Star Tortoises are not found in Singapore, they are not native to Singapore, they are likely to be culled and destroyed because they don't want to risk these species to be invasive and try to corrode the resident wildlife of Singapore. Now, the plan was, again, to set up another repatriation operation. That is the reason I had to leave from Delhi all the way to Bangalore, because the wildlife was smuggled out of Karnataka. And we had to set up a base to bring the wildlife back to India. So after all the paperwork was done, and this one was more extensive because this time we had to cross the seas and bring the tortoise back by air. So we had to loop in a lot of agencies. Even the British High Commission was brought into the loop, and the Indian High Commission in Singapore also extended their cooperation. Finally, after getting all the paperwork in place, we got these customized wooden boxes made to transport the tortoise, because we are looking at about 10 hours of journey for them from Singapore all the way to the Bangalore facility where they had to be released. Now, we cannot just release them into the wild, but we have to keep them under observation for some time. It's called soft release. So while I was in Singapore with my team setting up the entire operation and bringing them back to India, the other team was working out of Karnataka at an undisclosed location in a forest to set up a base to monitor these tortoises when they're released back into the wild. For a few months, we have to follow the protocol that they have to be kept under strict observation so that we can understand their survival and abundance and how they adapt to the native conditions. And finally, after a long journey, lots of paperwork, lots of permits, the stars make it to home and they are released into the wild. Now, the conclusion here is that, you know, you just don't need to follow a particular field to be a conservationist. You can be anything. You can grow up to be a lawyer, a doctor, an engineer, anything. But now the need of the hour is that you have to be a conservationist in action. Conservation is not just about saving one wildlife from extinction. It's also about promoting the law, the enforcing the law in place. It's about ensuring public health. It's also about economic development. I mean, if you are talking about smuggling of wildlife, that is the fourth most lucrative crime after narcotics, human trafficking, and arms. So we are looking at a big picture. We need to understand how we coexist with the wildlife that we share the landscape with. And we have to be very careful. And we should actually aspire to grow into ambassadors of conservation. Thank you.